trust in you. Pour your love into our hearts and draw us to yourself, and so bring us at last to your heavenly city, where we shall see you face to face. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Please sit for the readings.
A reading from the book of Numbers. The rabble among them had a strong craving, and the Israelites also wept again and said, "If only we had meat to eat. We remember the fish we used to eat in Egypt for nothing, the cucumbers, the melons, the leeks, the onions, and the garlic. But now our strength is dried up, and there is nothing at all but this manna to look at." Moses heard the people weeping throughout their families, all at the entrances of their tents. Then the Lord became very angry, and Moses was displeased. So Moses said to the Lord, "Why have you treated your servant so badly? Why have I not found favor in your sight that you lay the burden of all these people on me? Did I conceive all these people? Did I give birth to them that you should say to me, 'Carry them in your bosom as a nurse carries a suckling child,' to the land that you promised on oath to their ancestors? Where am I to get meat to give to all these people? For they come to me weeping and say, 'Give us meat to eat.' I'm not able to carry all these people alone, for they are too heavy for me. If this is the way you are going to treat me, put me to death at once if I have found favor in your sight, and do not let me see my misery." So the Lord said to Moses, "Gather for me 70 of the elders of Israel, whom you know to be elders of the people and officers over them. Bring them to the tent of meeting and have them take their place there with you." So Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord. And he gathered 70 elders of the people and placed them all around the tent. Then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke to him and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied, but they did not do so again. Two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the Spirit rested on them. They were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. And a young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." And Joshua, son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, one of his chosen men, said, "My lord Moses, stop them." But Moses said to him, "Are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his spirit on them." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter of James. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed, and the prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. With you. Hear the gospel of our Lord Christ according to Mark. After Jesus had finished teaching the disciples, John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterwards to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us. For truly I tell you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you bear the name of Christ will by no means lose the reward. If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you if a great millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life maimed than to have two hands and to go to hell, to the unquenchable fire. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life lame than to have 2 feet and to be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, tear it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and to be thrown into hell, where their worm never dies and the fire is never quenched. For everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its saltiness, how can you season it? Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." This is the gospel of the Lord. speak in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Please sit down. May I first say how wonderful it is to see so many people here from different churches, from St Mary's and St Mark's and St John's, not only from St Matthew's. I've taken a text. The harvest is plentiful, but the labourers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out labourers into his harvest, Luke 10. And I'll explain presently why I've chosen this text. In December 1958, my twin sister and I and our father were present here in this church as the new building was dedicated to the glory of God. Little did I think that 60 years later, I would again be in this church, but celebrating 25 years of ordained ministry. We never know what God has in store for us, however reluctant we are to respond to his call. The first call I received was when Anne and I were confirmed at St. Andrew's Surbiton when we were 14, and that is the text from Luke's Gospel for which I started my sermon. The second call came for a devout but forthright lady, Marjorie Cole, known to a few of you here. We were on pilgrimage to the shrine of Our Lady of Walsingham. Marjorie said to me, "What you should do is train to be a deacon." I just laughed. The seed was sown, but lay dormant for many years. The third call came when I was giving a presentation at a job interview. I heard a voice in my head saying to me, "You should be telling people about Jesus, not about management." Imagine my surprise. So began the discernment process towards ordination, encouraged by my then vicar, Father Chuck Blankenship, and my sister and brother-in-law. I trained on the Southwark ordination course, as I was to become a minister in secular employment. At that time, ordinands remained in their own sponsoring parish, and I was fortunate in having the support of Jill Craig here at St Matthew's, who chaired a support group consisting of my vicar, sister, my work manager, and my friend Muriel, who hosted the group. Jill was very protective of me, particularly when people at St Matthew's wanted me to take on a job. I was ordained deacon along with 18 other ordinands at Southwark Cathedral on the 29th of September 1996. What a memorable occasion, and what a lot of support I received from my family, friends, and St Matthew's. By this time, my 91-year-old mother had died, and I had negotiated to return to my paid employment for 4 days a week, having reduced my hours whilst I was training. I remained at St Matthew's for the next 4 years after my priesting in 1997. I remember the late Malcolm Barron giving me singing lessons to enable me to sing the office of evensong and essential parts of the Mass, singing not being my strong point. It's even worse now, so I very rarely do it. I moved to St Mark's Church within the parish in 2001, having retired from my paid work, and it's lovely to see some friends from there here today. So over these last 25 years, I worked with 12 priests, including 3 curates, served not only at St Matthew's, but St Mark's and St Mary's in the parish. I worked for 3 interregnum, or should that be interregna, in the parish. I've also taken services at St John's, other churches in the deanery, and St Michael's Convent, where I'm an associate. As you go about to different churches, you realise how uncommon common worship is, as no 2 churches conduct a Eucharist in the same way. What is memorable of the last 25 years is the people of the congregations that are important. It's being alongside people in their joys and sorrows that makes being a priest so worthwhile. Baptisms are joyful occasions, whether they're babies, young children, or older people. Remember Jesus' words in our gospel reading. "If any of you put a stumbling block before one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better if a millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea." Challenging words. One of my first baptisms here at St. Matthew's was Alice Ovens, now a young woman in her 20s, and how lovely it is that she's in the sanctuary serving today. There were many baptisms when I was at St. Mary's. They often happened at the more informal 11:15 service. And one memorable event when I was at St. Mary's was admitting Alice to Holy Communion. It's so lovely. It really brought tears to my eyes seeing Alice and her family in the congregation here today. Alice had slipped through the net of preparations for Holy Communion. And on the Sunday she was to be admitted to Holy Communion. Do you remember asking your family, were they excited that you're going to receive Holy Communion? Are we excited that we can receive Holy Communion? And another memorable baptism here at St. Matthew's was that of 8-year-old Anna Maria. And it's lovely to see her here today, but far older than 8. Her family had not been able to find a Christian fellowship in which Anna Maria felt comfortable. And do you remember at the baptism rehearsal, you rushed into the church, up to the sanctuary, pointed to the large chair and asked, is that the naughty chair? How lovely it was to be present a few years later when Anna Maria too was admitted to Holy Communion. So lots of lovely events. Our second reading from the Epistle of James refers to visiting those who are sick, praying over them and anointing them. When I was at St. Mark's Church, and it's good to see people here from there today, after prayerful preparation and training, we developed a healing ministry and held a healing service once a month. But what a privilege it has been, whichever church I've served in, to visit people in their own homes and to take them Holy Communion, anoint them, some very close to death, to pray with them and their relatives. How difficult it was during this COVID pandemic not being able to visit people in need in the same way, or during the first lockdown to be excluded from our churches. Each church in the parish has its own character. St. Mark's built in the round, so different from St. Mary's, or the more traditional St. Mary's with its box pews. The gates to the pews are very useful during the lively 11:15 service, as it's more easy to keep lively children under control. I moved from St. Mark's to St. Mary's when I was 70, and I wondered what would it be like moving up the hill. At that time, the rector, Mary Bide, was the only priest, a curate having left to be a vicar in Sevenoaks. St. Mary's was a challenge, with 4 services each Sunday, and it seemed like 4 completely different congregations. And it's good to see people from St. Mary's here today. Again, I enjoyed visiting people in their own homes, and also Lee House Care Home, where we took a Holy Communion service once a month. Although some members of the congregation might have had title, Sir, Lady, General or Major, it still didn't preclude them from illness or suffering or other problems. But there are not only sad events to remember, there are many joyful and happy events too in 25 years of ordained ministry. I remember officiating at my first wedding here at St. Matthew's. It was during an interregnum and Father Jeffrey was standing by in case there was a problem. Fortunately, there wasn't, only the bride arriving very late. Her husband-to-be was a rugby player and there were some of his fellow rugby players in the congregation getting very agitated as we waited for the bride. I remember the lively Chris Dingle services here at St. Matthew, St. Mark's and St. Mary's. What joyful occasions they were. The very lively carol services at St. Mark's and my first Mass of the Dawn at St. Mark's on a Sunday when we lost an hour's sleep, worrying whether I'd hear the alarm clock, but enjoying the smoked salmon and champagne breakfast after the service. Going to Iona for the St. Mark's Church during an October half term. Obtaining a BA Honours degree with the Open University after 6 years study. Again, another occasion for a family celebration. On a quieter note, but nevertheless enjoyable, I've led quiet days at St. Matthew's, St. Mary's and St. Mark's and for other organisations. I'm still a member of the Merton Spiritual Formation Group. We're planning a quiet day here at St. Matthew's in November. We read in the Gospels of Jesus frequently needing to draw aside to pray in a quiet place. We all need that. Another aspect of silence is the Julian Silent Prayer Meeting, named after Julian of Norwich. Susan Mayo and I started this silent prayer group 8 years ago, probably more now, when I was at St. Mary's, and it's now an ecumenical group. This group still meets regularly once a month, even though it had to be on Zoom for part of last year. Again, it's good to see some members here today. Another aspect of my ministry has been in the role of a spiritual director, which I've been undertaking for over 20 years under the auspices of the Southwark Spiritual Direction Network, known as SPIDER. Many people nowadays have no one to listen to them, so it's a privilege to be alongside people on their Christian journey. In the early days of my ordained ministry, I was actively involved with work with children and young people. As I've grown older and not enjoyed good health, I've concentrated more on work with older people or quieter aspects of ministry. However, wherever I've worked, the starting point has always been the celebration of the Eucharist. Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me." We can only serve God if we are spiritually equipped to do this. And the spiritual food we receive is through the sacrament of Holy Communion. This is the starting point for all Christians, whether they are priests presiding at the Eucharist or members of the congregation. This is true for me now as it was 25 years ago when I was ordained deacon. Looking back over the last few years, I was very grateful to Mother Helen in agreeing to my returning back to St. Matthew's. I've always regarded St. Matthew's as my spiritual home, even when I've been away. I'm grateful too for her care and concern during times when my health has not been good. Of course too, we've been very blessed here at St. Matthew's in having Father Alistair, our team curate, based with us. What a joyful celebration we had here in July on the occasion of his first Mass. What of the present time and the challenges of COVID? During the first lockdown, Mother Helen asked me to coordinate a housebound Holy Folk prayer group. I sent out prayer requests and initially a daily reflection called View from my window as I was spending a lot more time at home. I also presided at a Mass at home on behalf of the parish, letting the prayer group know what was happening and the readings for the day. And after initial stress, I managed the intricacies of Zoom with the help of a new computer paid for by the parish. What of the future? That is in God's hands. Next year, Anne and I will be entering into our 80th year. I have now to learn how to let go, let God, relinquishing more active forms of service and to pray for guidance from the Holy Spirit. At the same time, giving thanks for 25 years of ordained ministry and for all the people that have helped and supported me along the way. One special person who's always been there for me during times of illness, sorrow and times of joy has been my twin sister Anne, giving of herself. Without her support, I would not have been able to train for ordination or be the person I am today. I'd like to end with a prayer from the Bible Reading Fellowship, which seems appropriate as I celebrate my ordination as a deacon, but it's also a prayer which all of us can make our own. Stir us up to serve you, Lord, that in our serving others may see you, and as others see you in us, we may meet with you afresh in them, so that we in turn are stirred again to serve you with joy, day after day. Amen.
let us affirm our faith in God. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father.
St. Mark's Gospel today finished with the sentence, "Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with one another." We are the salt of the world. Let us not lose our saltiness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the life of the church. We pray for our Diocese of Southwark, and for all who worship within the Wimbledon team of churches. We pray for our partner churches in Matabeleland and Jerusalem, and this month we pray for the people of Durham Road. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for Mother Cynthia, and we are joined today by her family and friends celebrating her 25 years of being ordained. We give thanks for her vacation within the Wimbledon team of churches, and we give thanks for her prayerful support and her inspiration within St. Matthew's and the other churches within the Wimbledon team. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world. In light of ongoing stories of horror coming from Afghanistan, we pray for her people. We remember forthcoming elections within Germany. And within this country, we pray for all those disrupted by delivery problems and ongoing shortages of essential goods. And we pray for those people and families potentially affected by spikes in prices of goods. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are in pain, for those who are ill, for those who feel cut off and isolated. In particular, we remember Julian King, Norma Allington, Sheila Nettleton, David Puttenham, Helen Aylward, Heather Morey, John Taylor, and Muriel Brooks. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who have died recently. In particular, we remember Sabina Nessa, and we hold in our thoughts her family, friends, and the children taught by her, who are left to mourn her brutal death. We also pray that women and girls in society should be free to go about their business without fear of intimidation, harm, or death. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Closer to home, we pray for Joanne Sutcliffe, Stan Blackburn, Christopher Griffiths, priest, Linda and her daughter Juliet, who mourns her passing, and Martha and her whole family. And we pray for people whose anniversary of death falls at this time: Ruth Heath, Edna Partridge, Keith Renton, Alan Dawes, and Dorothy Taylor. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us bow down and worship you. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
We stand for the peace. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Let us pray. As the grain once scattered in the fields and the grapes once dispersed on the hillside are now reunited on this table in bread and wine, so, Lord, may your whole church soon be gathered together from the corners of the earth into your kingdom. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. From sunrise to sunset, this day is holy, for Christ has risen from the tomb and scattered the darkness of death with light that will not fade. This day the risen Lord walks with your gathered people, unfolds for us your word, and makes himself known in the breaking of the bread. And though the night will overtake this day, you summon us to live in endless light, the never-ceasing Sabbath of the Lord. And so, with choirs of angels and with all the heavenly host, we proclaim your glory and join their unending song of praise.
You are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of Mary, the Mother of God, Matthew, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Prayer for those joining us making their spiritual communion online. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Amen. Body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Everybody is very welcome to come and receive, whatever church you're from. There'll be two stations, if you like. Mother Cynthia will stand over there, and I will stand over there. Please just come to whoever is next. Please do sanitize your hands as you come up. And if you have not been prepared to receive the sacrament, then please do come up for a blessing anyway. We stand.
Let us pray. Lord, we pray that your grace may always precede and follow us, and make us continually to be given to all good works. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Please would you sit? All the notices and various other things. Let's do some notices first. Guess what? We're having a winter fair. Yes. A bit more enthusiasm? Yeah, we're going to be having a winter fair. And we need lots of helpers for the winter fair. And I know you've missed our fairs so much over the last few years. So this is your opportunity to now plunge straight back in, running the gift stall, the cake stall, the tombola, and all the rest of it. Please, can you speak to or email Sheila, Diana, or Janet? None of those people are here today, so you can just tell me if you want to help. Because we will, it does take a lot of people, a lot of work to put on our fairs, but they really are worth it, aren't they? They're fantastic, and they're a great opportunity to bring people into the church as well. Harvest Festival next week, please bring your gifts for Harvest Festival, and we will place them under the altar as we normally do. This year, as last year, we are supporting Wimbledon Food Bank, and there's a list of things that they need at the moment, and if you want to get an even more up-to-date list, then do go on to their website and you will discover. Jonathan is offering tours of his organ. Yes, he is. If you would like a tour of the St. Matthew's organ, then please do speak to him and he will show you all its tricks. And yes, you will be able to play very loudly, I think. Is that the offer?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. It's fascinating, actually, to go up into the gallery and to have a look. And I know that during the lockdown, when we were taking closer pictures of Jonathan playing the organ, lots of people were very interested in how it was done, and not just the hands, but the feet as well, and so on. So if you'd like to do that, then he's offering that. And please, can we have some more coffee makers? We need more baristas for making coffee after the service, as we're going to go back to having our refreshments. And if you'd like to do that, please speak to Leslie or Mary, who will be doing the coffee today. And please do stay after the Mass today, because not only do we have coffee and tea, but we have something stronger. Not just orange juice either, but we have some fizz, and we have cakes to be cut by Mother Cynthia. And thank you very much to Serena, Father Alistair's wife, who has made, at my special request, her fantastic golden syrup cake, which I could whole one myself. They're so delicious. There is also a vegan and gluten-free cake there for anyone for whom that applies. So do stay afterwards. Now, I've got something to give to Mother Cynthia, which I've got down here. Perhaps you would like to come up and stand at the front. What an amazing sermon of a long, long ministry. Yes, I think we should have. A really wonderful a kind of skip through 25 years, or even longer actually, since you first arrived here. And does it make you think, what can I do for the Lord? I hope so. Cynthia has been a great blessing on this church, as have actually the rest of her family, for many, many years. And I certainly am thankful as the priest here at the moment, but I know there are team vicars who went before me who will also have been very thankful for Mother Cynthia's support of their ministries by her ministry. Mother Cynthia has been very supportive of me during the time that I've been here. I've learnt a lot from her, I have to say, and I'm so glad that she's back here with us now in her ministry of preaching, presiding, and also prayer. Mother Cynthia is a prayer. Mother Cynthia is a prayer, and that is a wonderful thing. It's a great gift to a church to have somebody who prays. And so I'm very thankful to you, and I wish you many more happy years of ministry. But don't feel that you have to carry on longer than you feel you want to. A couple of things for you. Firstly, within this is a card and lots of cards from people. It's impossible to find a big anniversary card, but there's a smaller one in there, and then signed by lots of people, and then other cards as well. And there's also a check in there from people of the parish, not just St. Matthew's, but St. Mary's, St. Mark's and St. John's. So that those are for you to peruse at your leisure. And then also something just to, a little thing just to remind you of this day. Give it to you if you'd like to open that now. And a few little explanations. What does it say on the top?
All shall be well.
It says all shall be well on the top. And then would you like to take out what's in there?
Oh, it's a hazelnut.
It's a silver hazelnut. Why is a hazelnut important for you?
Julian of Norwich.
Yes.
And it's lovely to see our members of our silent prayer group here, because we had all during Lent, we had a Lent group on Julian of Norwich. So Julian of Norwich is very special. It's absolutely beautiful.
Oh, I hope it will be good. To use as an aid to prayer and reflection. The silver to remind you of our anniversary and the hazelnut of Julian. So thank you very much. And let's give Bob Cynthia another.
Well, I'm grateful. Is my microphone on? These things drive me mad. I think the battery's running down because I've had it on too long. Thank you to everyone here today, and it's so lovely to see people from all the different churches. Because, as I say, you know, served in many churches, and it's really good to have your support. But as I mentioned in my sermon, the one person that has been with me through everything is my twin sister Anne. And without her, none of this would be possible. I mean, she supported her husband Michael through his training. Daughter Judith had supported me all the way, continued through, you know, ill health, sorrows and joys. So Anne, this comes with all my love and prayers. I should enjoy looking at all these. Thank you very much again, and enjoy the bubbly and the cake.
Indeed, we know how to enjoy ourselves. That's what matters.
I think I'll leave those there for now.
Okay. Please stand for the blessing. The Lord be with you. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace, to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.